going to adopt you as my mommy and daddy. And I'm going to live here with you and steal from you and be, why? Because his nature hasn't changed. He's still a criminal. Why aren't we criminals? In a sense. If we were the children of the devil, wouldn't we be criminals? Because your father was a liar and a murderer from the beginning. We don't change from being children of the devil into the children of God. And we're going to do, I'm getting way off. I'm going to deal with that next week. Let me move on. We are already possessed by God. He owns us already. Because it tells us, third, he says, them also must I bring. Now, Jesus never fails in anything that he does. Do we ever see Christ failing at anything that he does? Do you think if he missed bringing one sheep into the fold, that he would be considered the good shepherd, the great shepherd, the faithful shepherd? If he missed saving one soul, do you think he would be accounted as a faithful shepherd? Saving all the lost that he was sent. He went out to seek and to save that which was lost. Do you think Christ ever failed at that? What kind of a Christ would we have if he failed at seeking and saving and finding all the lost sheep and bringing them into the fold? What kind of a God would we have if he failed at that? Yet there's people, preachers who preach that. Them also must I bring. That's kind of an emphatic statement. Must I bring? I must bring them. Jesus never fails anything that he did. Jesus said that he came to seek and to save that which was lost. Now, I don't know how many people think about what they read. We read things, we don't think about it. Let me ask you a question. If you lost something, was it not yours before you lost it? If you lost something, was it not yours before you lost it? How were the sheep lost? We were lost to the fall, to Adam. Because all of humanity was in Adam. And when Adam fell, all of humanity fell. Which meant that the sheep fell in Adam. Does that make sense? Is that what the scriptures teach? If you were lost, you had belonged at one time. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. Now listen, the Son received the elect from the Father, John 17:2. And the Son is to redeem them or buy them back from their fallen state and to restore them to their position in Christ, since they were since the position that they were in Christ since before the foundation of the world, in John 17:21. In other words, we were in Christ before the foundation of the world. We were lost through Adam, and it was Christ's covenant redemption, as part of the covenant of redemption, that he would take that which was lost and redeem them back and restore them back into the fellowship they had in Christ since before the foundation of the world. Now, that might be hard to grasp, and I admit to you it is hard to grasp, but it's easy to believe. You know, maybe I don't understand all that goes on there and all that's said, but I believe it because of what the Word of God says. Now, not one sheep will remain lost. There isn't a single sheep that belongs to Christ that will be lost. He promises that. He will find them all and save every one of his sheep. He will save every one of his sheep. If he fails at saving one, he has failed in the redemptive purpose and therefore cannot be a fit savior of men. Or of man. He couldn't be, but he is, because he's not failed and will never fail at saving every one that is lost. Amen. You know, I think about those parables, the parable of the lost coin, remember? Who loses part of her dowry? And what she does, she sweeps the house clean. She looks in every nook and cranny. She gets out the candle. In her day, we'd have out our powerful flashlight in our day, and we would be searching and seeking every corner, every crevice, every crack for that one coin until she finds it. Jesus knows where all his sheep are, and he goes out and saves them. Redeems them. Buys them back. He's bought them back. He paid the price of their redemption, which was certainly due. Now, over in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 25, we read this morning during our during the Lord's Supper. But in 1 Peter chapter 2, now I know, I didn't take 1 Peter out of here, so it's just good. There we go. It says, verse 2, verse 25, it says, "And we were the sheep, and we were as sheep, going astray. But now are returned unto the shepherd, the bishop of your souls." We are returned. We at one time were lost. We were going our own way. We were fit for destruction. But he, knowing where his sheep are, went out and saved them and delivered them. And we are now returned unto the shepherd of the sheep. Now in John 17, 14 through 16, I'm just going to go over there real quick, and then I'll ask a couple questions. John chapter 17, verse 14. "I have given them because I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of this world, even as I am not of this world." Now look at verse 16. "They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world." Now let me ask you, how was Christ not of the world? How was Christ not of the world? And immediately you think, in every way he was not of the world. Isn't that what we think? He was, forgive the term, but alien to this world, was he not? "They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world." Now, how was Christ not of the world? So were we not. So are we not of the world. Now, you think about that. And think of where that goes and its ramifications. You know what? I was meditating on this, and my brain was going one way. I thought, let's see what the commentarians say. And you know what? Neither one of them was going where my brain was going. I think, well, they were right in part. They didn't take it as far as it could be or as they should have. Listen, he had not the spirit of this world. Right? He did not have the spirit of this world. He had a temporal body, and he had a temporal body, and he has an eternal body. He had a pre-existence as the pre-incarnate God, correct? Now, we are not of this world, like Christ is not of this world. We have not the spirit of this world. Romans 8, 9 through 11. That's only one passage. I could find several others. We have not the spirit of this world. If Christ be in you, we have not the spirit of this world. Remember when John wanted to call fire down from heaven, and Jesus says, "Ye know not of what spirit ye are." Remember what he said? But you're not. You have not the spirit of this world. That is new man, right? Then, we also have a temporal body, but we also have an eternal body, 2 Corinthians 5:1. that we will put off this flesh and we will take on a heavenly body. When Christ died and put off his incarnate human body, he put on his spiritual body, right? His spiritual flesh. And what did they see after the resurrection? They saw him in his spiritual flesh. Or not as a spirit, they saw him in his eternal flesh and bone, the Bible says. Now, he was pre-existent as the pre-incarnate Son of God. We have a pre-existence in the pre-incarnate Son of God. You get that? We have a pre-existence in the pre-incarnate Son of God. In other words, we were in Christ before the foundation of the world. John 17, 2 and 21 and 10, chapter 10, 28 and 29. Let's go over to Ephesians chapter 1. We'll read over in Ephesians chapter 1 this morning about that. But we have been in Christ and had our, if you will, a pre-existence in Christ. We're going to prove that next week and the following weeks when we get into chapter 2. But in chapter 1, verse 3, it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us," what with? "With all spiritual blessings in the heavenlies in Christ." Where are those blessings come from? They're heavenly blessings, and they're where? In Christ. "According as he hath chosen us in him." When were we chosen? In him. Before the casting down, and that, the word foundation means the casting down of the world. Before the world was ever created, before time was ever created, we were in Christ Jesus. Before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. We were before him in love, holy and without blame. In Christ. And then it says, having predestinated. Oh, some people just hate that word. They despise that word. I mean, it's a biblical word. I didn't make it up. And if you have a problem with that, then your argument's with Paul. The word there is predestinated, to mark out aforetime, or to predetermine, or to decree. That's what the word predestination means. To decree us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. That adoption has to do with our flesh. Now listen, folks, we've been decreed in Christ before the casting down of the earth, before things were ever created. It had already been decreed and determined and set out, and our redemption in place, and everything set up before time was ever created. We were always his sheep. We ought to be excited about that. Because the great shepherd of the sheep came and sought you. He sought each one of us out, didn't he? And brought to us the great gospel blessing of justification. And preached unto us the gospel whereby we believe. Now, there's some people who think that a message like this, or that we believe that we were saved from eternity. Let me dispel that right now. I do not believe, nor do we preach, that we're saved from eternity. We were elect in eternity. And election is unto, and that means to or toward, salvation. We were elect in Christ in eternity. We belong to Christ in eternity, but we were dead, as we'll see in chapter 2, in trespasses and sin, till the time when we were born from above and experienced faith and repentance. We were, as far as God was concerned, everything was already done. Everything was already in place. We're already his sheep, and we're from eternity. But we were lost in Adam. We still had to have redemption's price paid. We still had Christ to do the work of redemption, which shows that the work is complete and finished. But this is quite different from experiencing redemption. We had yet to experience that redemption that we call being saved. That happens in time. You see, we've just run along merrily in our sin, just like the children of the world, and like we have within us the nature of the world. We'll see this when we get into Romans and into the next chapter. We're just like the children of wrath. However, but God, it says, but God, wherewith he loved us, with great love with which he loved us. We were, but we had yet to experience God's grace and his redemption. We had yet to experience that new birth and that conversion which came by Jesus Christ. We had yet to experience those things. You see, first, Christ is the great shepherd of the flock. Second, he was already in possession. Other sheep have I. They were his lambs. And then he says, them I must bring. So that there was nothing that Jesus failed to do. He brought and successfully all those sheep into one great flock of redemption. And we are in Christ, and Christ is in us. We have that fellowship among the saints as well. We're not saved in eternity, we're saved in time. Known unto God are all his works from the beginning, right? He knows them all. The work of redemption already paid for. He knew who his sheep were. He knew where they were, where he needed to go to get it. He knew what the redemptive price was. He paid it. Everything set in motion. Even our actual experience planned and purposed by God. Because we're not born of ourselves, are we? We're born of the Spirit. And it is the Spirit of God that moves upon us and creates within us a new creature created in Christ Jesus. We weren't looking for God. God was looking for us, wasn't he? He was looking for you. He was looking for me. And he found us. And just like Paul, he arrested us. Did he not arrest Paul on the road to Damascus? Was Jesus looking for Christ when he was on his road to Damascus? No, he's persecuting Christ because he's persecuting the people of God. And God arrested him right there on the spot. Brought him to his knees. That's what he does with every one of us when it comes to our redemption, when it comes to our experience of salvation. Does he not bring us to our knees, weeping and confessing that we're sinners, dirty, rotten, miserable sinners, and we pray that God would save us from our sin? Does that not happen? That's what happened to Paul, arrested on the road to Damascus. So are we, arrested and brought. Father, I want to thank you for your great grace to us today. Again, for your kindness. Father, thank you for saving us, redeeming us. We thank you that this is not a work of man, but it is the work of God, the saving of our souls. In your praise and glory, we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm glad everyone is able to be here. I am glad that you're here this morning, Alexia. And if you'll take your hymn books and you'll turn with me to hymn number 294. 294, Save Your Like a Shepherd Leads. Thank you. heart failure institute or clinic, I guess it is, and they had me take a blood test before I went and saw them. My blood test came back when I was there, and there's what they call BNP numbers, which tell you how badly your heart failure is. Well, when I went in and had the procedure done, they put the stent in, my BNP number was 4,000. Now, the higher the number, the worse that it is. Most people, someone with their heart in good health, has BNP numbers at about 100, 115. Mine were at 4,000. Well, this week, when I had the blood test done, they had already dropped to 1,000. So that's an improvement. And hopefully with the medication and everything, like I said, I'm feeling very good this week. And my blood pressure is the lowest it has ever been that I can remember in recent history, consistently. Even in the morning, you know, your blood pressure is a little high in the morning. I was surprised at where it was even on the morning breathing. So I'm kind of excited about that. I feel good. And we'll just stay on the regimen, keep the sodium down, limit the water intake, which I'm not finding having problems limiting that. I suppose I haven't run out working really hard yet. I don't know if I'll be able to, but we'll see. But anyways, things are going well. I'm sure if things stay on the, I expect to see those numbers even come down more, if possible. And so we're kind of excited about that. Continue to pray for me, and I for you. Let me call your attention this morning to John chapter 10. John chapter 10. Now my subject is going to be the great block of redemption. And in approaching this, the subject kept growing. And there's many aspects to the redemptive work of Christ in his flock, in the redemption of his flock. And and our base verse here is John chapter 10, verse 16, where it says, "And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." So we're talking about the great flock of redemption, not just Jews, of whom he is talking to now and who his subject is, because the Jews, right, was sent to the lost house of the sheep of Israel. The gospel went first to Israel. When the disciples were commissioned and sent forth, they were to go throughout Israel, but not into the cities of Samaria, nor into the Gentiles. That was the commission. But they were to go to Israel first. And so this is whom Jesus is addressing when he says that there are more to this flock. Other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also must I bring, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall be one fold and one shepherd. So in the looking at this, we're going to be looking how Christ made one fold out of two people, if you will. Father, I want to thank you for your grace and kindness. I want to thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who made of two one man. And Father, how that you have established your churches upon this earth for God's people to meet together in, and that this is the ordained place of worship and praise and glory. And we see this as a pattern given to us throughout the New Testament. Father, we want to thank you for thy kind grace and thy kind mercies, that you would attend with us this morning, that we might continue to lift up praises to thee, that our worship will be acceptable unto thee, that we will come together with hearts and looking to thee for blessing. Father, we ask that you will feed us with the manna from heaven, and that thy word will settle and have lodge and lodge in our hearts, that we might give thee praise and glory throughout all our days. In Jesus' name, amen. The work of our Lord Jesus Christ and the work of redemption is often misconstrued, distorted, and oftentimes not understood. It's one of those things. This verse itself, where it says, "Other sheep have I, other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also must I bring, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall be one fold and one shepherd. This is one of those verses that is often misconstrued, misunderstood, distorted, because there is a lack of a comprehension of the redemptive work of Christ in making one flock one flock of sheep, if you will. One flock of sheep. Now, first, let's note some things. And like I said, as I was studying this and going through this, we're going to also go into Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 22. Not today. I've decided just to preach my introduction because there's no way I'm going to get into the body of the message today. So I hope you'll forgive me for that. I hope that the introduction will suffice for our spiritual needs today. But to let you know, there's more to come, because we're going to learn how he made out of two one. And it tells us that in Ephesians chapter 2. But first, let's note in this text, it says, other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Let's first note that Christ is the great shepherd of the flock. Christ is the great shepherd of the flock. There are no other shepherds. I am not a shepherd. I would be an under-shepherd at best, which means that I serve under the chief shepherd, under the great shepherd in the flock that God has given me responsibility for. And I am to do as he would do. He feeds the flock. He leads them into still waters. He takes care of his flock. And I'm to do exactly what the chief shepherd dictates me to do in this small assembly that we have. But there is one shepherd. One shepherd. And Christ is that shepherd. There's one pastor over the churches of Christ. One, and the word pastor or pastoral means a shepherd. That's where we get the word pastor from, is one who shepherds sheep. It's his pastoral duty. He pastors the church, the sheep, as he takes them out and leads them to green pasture. All right. Now, let's look at some verses. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 34. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, and Ezekiel chapter 34. Beginning with verse 11. Ezekiel 34:11. For thus saith the Lord God, behold, I, even I, will both search my sheep and seek them out. Bless the Lord. What did Jesus say? I come to seek and save that which was lost. What does it say here? Behold, I, even I, will both search my sheep and seek them out. As a shepherd seeketh out his flock in the day that he is among his sheep that are scattered, and I will seek out my sheep and will deliver them out of all places where they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day. And I will bring them out from the people and gather them from the countries, and I will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in good pasture, and upon the high mountain of Israel shall their fold be, and they shall lie in a good fold and in the fat pasture, and they shall feed upon the mountains of Israel. And I will feed my flock, and I will cause them to lie down, saith the Lord God. And I will seek that which was lost, and bring again that which was driven away. And I will bind up that which was broken, and I will strengthen that which was sick. But I will destroy the fat and strong. I will feed them with judgment. That is, those who are not sheep. And as for you, O my flock, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I judge between cattle and cattle, between the rams and the he-goats. So the Lord is the great shepherd, and he will call out all of his sheep. He will seek out all of his sheep. them into one fold, and he will be their great shepherd. And verse 22 of that same chapter says, therefore I will save my flock, and they shall be no more a prey, and I will judge between cattle and cattle, and I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, even my servant David shall he feed them, and they shall be, and he shall be their shepherd. And who is the servant if it is not the Lord Jesus Christ? And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken it, and I will make with them a covenant of peace. And I will cause the evil beast to cease out of the land, and they shall dwell safely in the wilderness and sleep in the wood. We have great safety in the presence of the great shepherd. And the shepherd of the sheep is David. Symbolically, it is Christ who is the great shepherd of the sheep. And we have been brought into, we are to be brought into one fold. And there is one shepherd, that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And then over in John chapter 10, beginning in verse 11, John 10 verse 11, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. And he that is a hireling, and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, and leaveth the sheep, and fleeth. And the wolf catcheth them, and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth, because he is the hireling, and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. Who is the good shepherd? It is Jesus Christ. Verse 15, and I the Father, and the Father knoweth me, even so I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also must I bring, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall be one fold and one shepherd. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20 and 21 says, now the God of peace, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, if you listen to that verse and went back to Ezekiel, you heard the same thing. Talked about he being our peace, and that he set up a covenant with his people, and that he was the great shepherd, and he is the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant. It is nice. Not nice. That's what such a nice word is. It is marvelous. It is wondrous that we, as the sheep of God, are in a covenant relationship with the Son and with the Father. We didn't make the covenant. This is a one-sided covenant between God the Father and God the Son, where God the Son covenanted to redeem his people, redeem his sheep. That's what we're talking about, is redemption. That means to redeem. We'll get into this, but it means to buy back. Now, I want us to notice, second, first of all, that Christ was the great shepherd, and second, these sheep are already his possession. Verse 10, look what it says. Other sheep I have these sheep. I have other sheep. They already are in possession. It didn't say that I have to go out and find more sheep. I know there's more sheep out there, and I need to go out and find them. I can't have any of them lost or scattered about. And I'm going to go see if I can find them. He says, I have sheep. I have others. They're already mine. I already possess them. Other sheep I have. These sheep are not unknown unto him. Now, there are a lot of people who preach that Jesus doesn't know anything. He didn't know who was going to be saved until he looked down into the future somehow and then figured out you were going to be saved, and therefore you're elect. That's how he knew. It's because he had the foresight to look ahead into the future, and that's how he knew. What kind of a Christ is that? What kind of a God is that that's so dependent upon what man does in order to make his own decisions? That's the truth, isn't it? Christ has to make a decision on election. But he can't do that on his own. He's got to see what you're going to do first. What are you going to do? And then I'll write it down there. I'm going to write you in the last book of life because I can see what you're going to do up there in the future. Isn't that silly? That's about as silly a thing as I ever heard. And yet there are men standing in pulpits today that preach that and believe that and teach their people that. How silly is that? And you say, well, Dave, you make it so simplistic, you make it sound silly. Well, it is. It is that simplistic. God could not decide who to elect, but decided to take a sneak peek into the future of his creation so that he could figure out what you were going to do. Because he didn't know what you were going to do with the gospel. So he took a sneak peek in the future, saw what you were going to do with the gospel, and said, aha, he's going to be elect. And write it down. So now you're elect before the foundation of the world. Really? That's about as silly as you can get. And it's nowhere found in God's Word. It's not taught anywhere in God's Word. I'll assure you of that. I have not had anybody ever show me it yet. Now these sheep are not unknown. He knows where each of his little lambs are and where to seek for them and how to deliver them from their sinful, wicked condition. He knows all that. He knows what it's going to take to redeem them. And he paid the price. And he knows where each one of them are. So he knows where to seek for them. Keep seeking to save that which was lost. Doesn't mean that he didn't know where you were. You just didn't know where you were. Think about that a little bit. He always knew where you were. You didn't know. You didn't know you were a sheep. You didn't know that you were lost. You were lost to him in a sense, but he paid redemption price and bought you back. We'll talk a little bit about that here in a minute or two. These dear little lambs belong to him and to no other, and these have yet to be brought into the fold where there is one shepherd and one fold. They are those who yet have to be brought. He says, I know where they are. I have other sheep, have I. They also need to be brought into the fold. They aren't in the fold yet, but they need to be, and they're going to be. Amen. Them I must bring. And we'll bring, that's another point. We're going to get to that next. But in John chapter 10, 1 through 5, he says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not in by the door of the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door of the shepherd is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep heareth his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. My sheep know my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. John chapter 10, verse 27 and 28. Folks, Jesus calls us out by name. And he knows his sheep, and his sheep know him, and we recognize the voice of the shepherd. We don't hear anyone else. In fact, it says in the scripture, if we read through John chapter 10, that we flee, that we run away from anyone else, but the shepherd's voice we know. He knows his sheep, and his sheep know him. Now, that's marvelous. They're his possession. They don't belong to anybody else. Now, there's a lot of people. I don't know if that's in this week's sermon or next week's sermon. I know I'm going to mention it. That's next week's sermon. But I'll just mention here. We were never the possession of the devil. We were never the possession of the devil. Never the possession of the devil. Now, Now, a lot of people, and we're going to deal with this in, when we get over to Ephesians chapter 2. A lot of people go to Ephesians chapter 2 and say, see, you are the children of the devil. Not once does it say we were children of disobedience in that passage. Not once. I don't want to get ahead of myself because I'm going to go through that. And I think it's important that we have an understanding and a comprehension of these things. Because preachers get up all the time and say, you are the children of the devil, and God saved you and put you into his family. Well, how does that meet with being a sheep? You mean you were a goat and then you were transformed into a sheep? Is that how it works? How did that happen? How did you get to be in the family of the devil and all of a sudden you're made into the family of God? I'll tell you what, you can't become a member of this family unless it's by adoption. But that doesn't change your nature any, does it? There's some things that are involved here that it's contrary to nature to even think that you can move from one family to a different family and think that you're automatically part of that family. Now, if I went and joined myself across the street to the neighbor and said, hey, I'm your family member, I'm going to sit down and have dinner with you, and where's my bedroom, and do you think they might be objectionable to that? Yeah, I think so. Suppose some criminal...